Praise the Lord. Start over here. God is good and He is greatly to be praised.
Amen.
And everybody that's watching, I'm Pastor Chan Smith, founder and senior pastor of Revivalist here church. We are located currently at Comfort Suites in LaGrange, Kentucky. Come out. Sunday school starts at 5:30. Church service starts at 6:30 every Sunday night. We might have Sunday morning soon. That's up to the Lord. So keep track on all that information by going to revivalishere.org. That's revivalishere.org. I'm going to share some things before we get into the praise and worship God's put on my heart. Might be a lot, but I think it's going to be good stuff. God's given me some good stuff tonight to preach on. So I encourage everyone to stay as long as you can. I got a little video clip, so I want to play from the Toronto Blessing. But I want to first talk about 1 Chronicles 17, verse 4. It's really hit me. And this is not really emphasized in my sermon that God's given me but for today. But this is really good. 1 Chronicles 17, starting in verse 4. This actually goes through verse 15. It says, go, well, before that, David was praying and he inquired the prophet Nathan wanted to build a temple. Then he said, go, God's with you. Then this is, starts after it. It says, go tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, you shall now build me a house to dwell in, for I have not dwelt in a house since the time that I brought up Israel, even to this day, but have gone from tent to tent and from one tabernacle to another. Wherever I have moved about with all Israel, have I ever spoken a word to any of the judges of Israel whom I commanded to shepherd my people, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now therefore, thus shall you say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the sheepfold, from following the sheep, to be ruler over my people Israel, and I have been with you wherever you have gone, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. Whoo, I feel God falling on this. And have made you a name like the name of the name of the great men who are on the earth. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people and plant them that they may dwell in a place of their own and move no more. Nor shall the sons of wickedness oppress them any more as previously. Since the time I have commanded judges to be over my people Israel, also I will subdue all your enemies. Furthermore, I will tell you that the Lord will build you a house, and it shall be when your days are fulfilled, when you must go to be with your fathers, that I will set up your seed after you, who will be of your sons, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build me a house, and I will establish his throne forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. And I will not take my mercy away from him as I took it from him who was before you. I will establish him in my house and my kingdom forever, and his throne shall be forever. According to these words and according to all this vision, so Nathan spoke to David.
Amen.
Now that's talking about, when I read this, it hit me, and it said seed. And it hit me, that's talking about Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
That's talking about Jesus, not Solomon. Because obviously that temple didn't stay.
Sure.
Solomon didn't live forever, and obviously his descendants after him wasn't on the throne. It's talking about Jesus building a house. And once it talk about in the New Testament, we are the temples of the Holy Spirit. When we become born again, you know, Jesus makes his temple. He makes us born again. So that's what that's talking about. And I just wanted to share that because it really hit me. And that's what, this is good. This is really good. I love the whole Bible. I've been reading the Old Testament a lot lately. And I love that too. I've really been getting a lot out of the Old Testament. There was a time where I read through the New Testament, kept reading it over and over and over several times. Then when I got back into the Old Testament, then God just really just bringing out stuff on that. I just been loving the Old Testament. So God is good. He is greatly to be praised.
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. I ask you, God, as you just fall in the name of Jesus. Fall in the name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Going to be in the paper this week in the Tribune and Oldham advertising. It's going to be a big section. So get people in here. Pray about this. We might try to get on the over-the-air channel maybe for a month just to broadcast four services, you know, half-hour programs, one a week maybe just to get people out here. If that's over there and it'd be on cable, but it's not on DirecTV or satellites or nothing. But that might be a thing to do too, just to get people out here and just God's moving. So several healings last week, so I'm excited about that. Trying to get some revivalist guests out here. God put it on my heart to get hold of Amber Brooks. She is Sister Amber Brooks. She is the worship leader at the Catch the Fire Raleigh. She studied at the Morning Star, which that is Rick Joyner, Pastor Rick Joyner, Prophet Rick Joyner. He bought the OPTL, that complex. And I emailed her directly, and she hasn't replied, obviously, because I did it late last night, and it's a Sunday now, which I haven't checked in a while. She might have, I don't know. But trying to get her out here, some people from Bethel, God put on my heart to try to get Sister Ruth. She pastors at Catch the Fire Central, and she was the assistant to John Arnott for a while, but Central to Catch the Fire Central, which that's in Central Toronto. It's in Toronto. And then have the main one, of course, is in Toronto. And it's grown so much, her and her husband has to just take over that because it's been growing. They had to do some more services. God's really reaching out. God's really hit her and her husband. They just shake. It's just powerful. And they did the music some at the Toronto Blessing. Amber Brooks did some music at the Sister Amber Brooks. Did the music at the Toronto Blessing, the anniversary. So I'm trying to get them out and maybe get Duncan Smith, which he's got the last name Smith, so of course I want to get him out. He's got to be anointed with the last name Smith, okay?
Amen.
And trying to get him out too because he's a pastor at Catch the Fire Raleigh, but he's got some of the good anointing rubbed off on him. You got to get these people that's anointed and revivalist and get that impartation. You get the impartation by the laying on of hands. That's in Scripture. It's in the Old Testament too with Elijah and Elisha. Elisha hung around Elijah and wouldn't let Elijah go anywhere without him.
Amen.
The New Testament talks about the laying on of hands. To stir up a gift with the laying on of hands. And talks about it many times about the laying on of hands. That's why it's important to go out and where God is moving. To get the laying on of hands. Of course, you can get a little bit while watching it. But you're not going to get the impartation, full impartation, unless you go and get the laying on of hands. I've been to services with Pastor John Arnott, Pastor John Kilpatrick, and Pastor Rodney Howard Brown, and all these people, Evangelist Randy Clark, I've been services with these people. I rubbed elbows with them. You know, when I got ordained, I had these mighty men and women of God. Brother Clay DeKeith was there too, laid hands on me. I've been Brother Pastor Clay DeKeith's services. Revival hit there in 94. And I've been, and I'm just hungry to go out, and I wanted more. I want more now. I'm more hungry now than I ever was. I want God. I watched the Toronto Blessing. I got so hungry. I just cried. I just wanted to be there. I just wanted to quit my job and drive up there to Toronto and go to Toronto Blessing.
Right.
Go to that anniversary. I wanted to be there. I just couldn't stand it. I was watching. I just couldn't stand it. Randy Clark, this past week had a healing school at Bethel, and they filled the big the Civic Center that. There in Reading, they filled it up and had people that still couldn't get in. It was packed. I wanted to be there. I just couldn't handle it. I wanted to be there. I'm hungry. I want to be there where these. I'm a pastor. Now I tell you that I still want to be there where God's moving in these other places.
That's
Amen.
But you got to be hungry. You got to go out there and just to get, go after God. And you got to be willing to put God first and be willing to go to these places where God is doing. And come out here. God's moving here. And you got to be willing to just go out and go catch it. Many times, the Toronto blessing, the biggest thing was it's so catchable. It's addicting that when people got hit, they would come back to their churches and then would break out. That was the biggest thing about the Toronto blessing. There wouldn't be no Brownsville revival if it wasn't for Toronto blessing. I don't know if you know that or not.
That's right.
So that was the biggest thing about the Toronto blessing. It's still going on. It was catchy. Pastor Shayon and Pastor the H Rock Church in Pasadena, California. He went there, got an impartation, went back, revival hit his church. And big things are going on still in Pasadena. In Bethel, that's where they got their impartation from, Toronto Blessing. There's a lot of people. And got Heidi Baker, Sister Heidi Baker, that's where she got her impartation was at the Toronto. She was wanting to give up. She said if it wasn't for Toronto Blessing, she would be teaching at a seminary right now. Mm-hmm. These people that went up there, they were hungry. They was at the very last of their, a lot of you would hear about their marriage was on the rocks, getting ready to get divorced. And they went up there hungry. A man from Elam, I'm going to try to play that a little bit in that prophecy here in a minute. He went up there, over there, he was hungry. He was hungry. God hit him, and it's a good testimony. You just watch it here in a minute. But you got to get hungry. I just can't instill that enough, people. You got to listen to me. You got to get hungry for God. You got to go out all after Him. When you worship, you got to get out there and just worship God. Don't worry about anyone else. You get out there in the aisles and you just shout to the Lord and worship Him. And who cares what anybody thinks?
That's right.
Who cares if they don't like that you're shaking or whatever? I don't care what they think. I'm going to get all God has to have for me. I want it.
That's right.
Because this is life here is but a vapor. Eternity in heaven is what you got to worry about.
Amen.
So you got to go all out after God. You got to be hungry for Him. The people that's going to make it to heaven are the hungry people that are hungry for Him. Because He said, "Behold, I never knew you." You got to have that relationship. You got to be hungry for Jesus. You got to want to be in His presence.
Yes.
When you're really in a relationship with someone, you really love them. You just want to just be with them all the time and just get them to love on you. Just hug on them and kiss them, and they kiss you. That's what you do in a real relationship when you love someone, even with your family members. There's nothing wrong with giving someone a kiss on the cheek. Some good affirmation. And that's what Jesus wants to do here tonight, is affirm, give some good affirmation and love on you. The love on you. There's nothing wrong with being loved on. There's nothing wrong with giving people compliments.
Amen.
And that's what Jesus wants to do, is come down and touch you and love on you and give you compliments. There's a lot of people got to set free in the healing school with Randy Clark. It's powerful. God wants to come down. I'm telling you tonight that you get in and worship God and you draw close to Him, let me tell you something. He'll come down and whammy you. You'll never be the same. I don't care what's going on. You watching, I don't care. You love on God and He will come down and love on you. You might be down on that last rope at the very end and you think you can't make it. Let me tell you something. That's the place of where your greatest miracle is going to be. You hear what I'm telling you tonight? I don't care how down that you are. You need to call out to Jesus. Let me play this up.
You know, the Holy Spirit is so...
That's John Arnott's daughter.
He knows exactly who you are, exactly where you are. And if you'll just put your trust in Him, or maybe for some of us, like me, I was a veteran. I'd been saved for 30-some years at the time. A veteran, and just said, "But Holy Spirit, this is different. I don't understand. But you I know. And you I'll trust." And so it's just been glorious. Thanks.
Lori was one of the ones that would just get so wrecked in the presence of God, in a good way, I'm talking about. I remember the one night she was just going through the motions of pulling in the nets. Now you think, 3 or 4 minutes of that, you kind of get it, wouldn't you? But when that goes on for like, I don't know how long you went, an hour and a half or more, just pulling in the nets, and she's tired, her arms are tired, but she's pulling in fish, catching hundreds and hundreds of souls. And the Lord is saying to her, just a few more, just a few more, keep going, just a few more. And see, that's what we did until 1, 2, 3 o'clock in the morning many, many times. Well, we soon got it over to the other side of the Atlantic, and people like David Campbell came along. Come on up, David, and share a testimony with us. David was a pastor in the Elam Churches, which is a large Pentecostal denomination in the UK, and now he's a district leader, regional leader. And he's been a very, very dear friend of mine. If he ever lost his job in the ministry, he could make a lot more money being a comedian on television. But anyway, tell us what happened to you, David, when you first came over here 20 years ago.
Gosh, it was not what we expected, really. I'm a third generation Pentecostal, and so I sort of thought, I heard this story. We had a vineyard pastor come to us in February 94, said he'd been to a vineyard church where people were stuck to the floor. Somehow that seemed attractive to me. I thought, I might to go and see that. I didn't think it happened to me, but I thought that'd be fun to watch, really. If nothing else, really. I thought, that must be really cool to see that. And so we turned up about May time, and lots of things happened in the sort of how many hours we got. Because I'll tell you one of the things that I found very interesting when I came the first time, is that obviously it's the old building and the last building. And Val Dodd was speaking, because John wasn't there that night. Yeah. Like something's good on TV or something, I'm not sure what it was. And we weren't there. But Val was speaking. The first thing he said was, if you're really serious with God, cut the front. I thought, if you spent £1,000 and float across the Atlantic, of course I'm serious. I'm Scottish, this is an accent, it's not an impediment, this is... Where I come from, everyone speaks like this. When you get to heaven, you'll speak like this too, so you better get used to this. It's just the way it is. So I thought, right, I'll go for that. And when he came to the front, he said, ladies go that side, men go that side. And when you get the other, when you get through there, confess your sins to each other. I thought, that wasn't what I thought. I thought we'd get stuck to the floor. I didn't know about it. And I brought my, another one of my pastors. I said, so you go that side, now go this side. I wanted him to have freedom. I don't know. And when we get in this group, because often people forget what it's like. It's a call to holiness and a call to be in his presence and for intimacy. And that's why I had it. And family, in this group, and as all men, and they all sort of, I'm British, so I think, you know, after you. And this gentleman said, do you mind if I go first? We all went, oh yeah, you go first. And he says, he was actually a Methodist, and he said, I come here, but you know, I've got a confession. I'm addicted to pornography, and I don't tell anyone. I go, oh, that's thanks for sharing that. Because I'm sitting there thinking of something small to share. You know what I mean? Then the next person says, well, actually, I often go to conferences, and my church sends me, but I don't go to evening meetings. I go to gay bars. And will you pray for me? And I go, yeah, we'll pray for you. I'm now trying to think of something big to confess. You know, because now some of you might think that'd be easier than you think. That was a sad man to die. You're all dying to know what it was I had to confess, didn't you? You wicked gossip-filled people. I don't. Actually, when it came my turn, I said, I think I must be full of pride because I can't think of anything to say. And you know, they all agreed.
Amen. Amen.
Maybe they're right. And as time went through, as I've been to pray for, I'm I'm like lamppost ministries. You know, you get the lightning rods. I'm like the lamppost, and so the lights are on, but nobody's in. You know what I mean? So I get prayed for him like that. Yeah, thank you very much. Off you go. So praying for me was not that easy. In fact, I'd never really fallen over, really. I think it's because the catchers were behind me going, oh God, no. There's only three of us here. So I'm standing there, and it's late at night. Ian Ross was there, I remember that sort of. I mean, I had a great time. David Pitches had just been there, the bishop. He was roaring like a lion. But he's an Anglican, so we sort of expect that off them, you know, the English Anglicans, they're the most. Anyway, so I was sort of adopting the position. Do you know what? If you just sway a little bit, they come to you quicker. So, it's just an observation. It's not theological, it's just an observation. So I'm standing there. And I hear this voice saying, can I pray for you? And I turned around, and there's nobody there. I thought, wow. And then I looked down, there's a little old lady there, and I nearly took her eye out with my thumb as I turned around, and she ducked. Now, I'm not preaching, so I'll just tell you the truth, okay? This is funny, isn't it? And I saw, I'm sorry, this is just the way it was. When I saw the little lady, I went, oh no. Oh no, and I hate that. Do you know what I mean? In our church, we preach. It doesn't matter who prays for you, it's in whose name. It doesn't matter who it is. And I'm the sort of person that'll be praying for people, and you see folks sidling over to get you, and as I get near them, I go, no, I go over here. And I'm doing it, and I'm thinking, that's terrible. That poor little lady, I'm judging her. So I'm trying to repent and smile at the same time. Now, I've been brought up in church, I can do that. Just she looked up at me and said, you know, before this move of God happened in our church, I'd never pray for anyone. And I thought, oh, that's really good. It's really comforting me. And she said, but since then, I've prayed for several people already. I thought, oh. And then the pastor in me kicked in. I thought, have a go. Practice on me, because when you go, somebody else will come. I'm just telling the truth now. The problem is 20 years later, I'm nearly as old as she was. I'm the little old man now. So I was standing there, and she said, I pray for lots of people, and you're a pastor. I thought, wow, what a mighty woman of God. So I wonder how she knows. In those days, in England, we had an advert on television for breakfast cereal. And you had a glow around you. And I thought, I wonder. She wondered if she saw the glow. And just felt the anointing or something. I said, yeah, I am. And she said, I knew it because they're the hardest to pray for. As she said those words, I fell backwards on that. Now that was a concrete floor in those days. With a lot of thin carpets. And I'm not complaining. But that little old lady made no attempt to catch me whatsoever. So I'm saying. Which is probably just as well. Did you imagine the local newspaper visiting Scotsman crushes little old lady at Trumbull Airport? That wouldn't have been good. So I'm lying there on the floor, and I'm just having a great time. And I could hear somebody laughing, which is okay. I mean, really, that's the last thing you expect to hear in church, isn't it, really? So, but it was okay. It was just a sort of like, it wasn't, it was like, And then I said, listen to this, I thought, oh no, it's me. laughing. Oh dear. And I didn't know what to think about it. I thought, well, it must be all right because I'm doing it. I mean, if somebody else is doing it, it could be false, couldn't it? But I'm doing it. I'm doing it. And it's like, it wasn't like if you were in England, the Blackpool policeman, you know, wasn't it? But it was just British, really good. And then Pierre sort of, and you know, at the distance, I hear a lady going, well, and I kept thinking, that's a shame, and bless her heart, I'm glad I'm laughing. I mean, if there's a choice. And then I noticed something. Every time she went, I went, and I thought, that's really bad. I mean, that's not right. Every time that poor lady cries, it makes me laugh. And do you know what? That just seemed really funny. So I was laughing away. And at one point, have you seen how when a child falls over, they hurt themselves, go, and then they run towards their mom. And when they get to the mother's arms, they go, ah! Well, this lady found daddy's arms. She went, ah! And I just roared with laughter. I thought, this is the funniest thing in the world. And I lay on the floor and I laughed literally 45 minutes. Really, really laughing. Now, when you laugh, your diaphragm goes up and down for 45 minutes. This is a large area of my body we're talking about here. This is not an insignificant happening. But the time I get up, I was in agony. That was precious. And I knew who this lady was. You know, you watch him pray. My Stanislav and Fred had a similar experience. This lady, she came up to me, she says, I saw her walking towards me, I thought, I need to apologise, this poor woman. And then she came up to me, I said, she said, can I have a word with you? I said, yeah, I want you. She said, not me first. I thought, okay, I'm a gentleman. She said, I've come to apologise to you. I said, you've come to apologise to me? Okay. Why? I thought, she's been out to scratch my car or something. I know she's done. So what, why? She said, every time you laughed, it made me cry. I said, no. Every time you cried, it made me laugh. She said, I didn't realize God could do more than one thing at a time in a meeting. I thought we had altar calls so specific. If you're here tonight and you're wearing a blue suit with a red tie and yellow socks, we're going to pray for your colour blindness. Come to the front and we'll pray for you. I thought, as specific as that, that's the way it was. And that's what happened to me. But I just, because I came desperately hungry. Do you know what I think? Most of us, we came here because we're hungry. And this room is filled with hungry people. I've come back because I'm still hungry. And I think I've got more, I'm not boasting, but I think I've got more of the Holy Spirit in my life now than I've ever had. But I actually feel hungrier than I've ever been. And I just think, God, let the hunger out tonight. Let the hunger out and he'll come. Let the hunger out and he'll come.
Oh my goodness, David, you. We've got two guys behind me just in case. But I love the inner movement, you know, because he went home and it spread throughout their whole denomination. And as far as I know, the Elam Fellowship in the UK is the only denomination that absolutely embraced the move of the Holy Spirit out of this place. So stretch your hands to one of them and say, get it. Well, you know, just as we were kind of getting in the swing of things, if you know what I mean, we'd had some amazing meetings. I'd never spoken to a crowd of 1,000 people or anything like that before, and it started happening again and again in Anaheim and in Texas and different places that we were being invited to. And then we had our own Catch the Fire conference at the Constellation Hotel, which is no more, sadly. But anyway, they tore it down a couple years ago. But it was absolutely jam-packed with about 3,000 people or more for Catch the Fire number one. And it was an amazingly powerful. How many were at that conference? How many got touched at that conference and never to be the same again? Well, you may remember that David Roos, after leading a great set, went off into this shaking, powerful, prophetic word that I wanted to show you tonight. Maybe we'll get it together for another night. It's not coming up properly, but anyway, it was so powerful. And what he was saying is, you have not seen anything yet. If you think this is my wind, this is not my wind. My wind is going to blow the nations right into the Father's love and into the heart of God and all of this stuff. And he said, what I'm doing is growing a plant that my wind will blow the seeds of this plant to the nations of the world. And it's going to be so much more powerful than anything we've ever imagined. And so it was unsettling to think that the height of the power. See, it was so contagious and so powerful. You would just have to look at people almost, they'd fall out under the power. And it happened in the elevator. It happened at the restaurant. It happened on the street. I can remember at that same hotel watching the same people come back down on the elevator that just went up. They couldn't get off, you know. And all those kinds of things. And so to think that it was going to be even more powerful was amazing. So I would like us all to stand right now and just make a decision that you are going to believe God for more after all these years.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus.
Take someone by the hand and say, Lord, I believe for more.
We believe for more, Lord.
Fire on them all, Lord God, in Jesus' wonderful name.
Hallelujah.
Let heaven open. Let the rain come. Let the wind blow. Let the fire fall. We absolutely want all that you have. In the name of Jesus, and we want it to go forth again from here to the nations, a rippling, unstoppable move of the Holy Spirit, kind of like what's in the book of Acts. Okay. Turn to a couple people near you and say, fire on you.
Fire on you.
And you can take your seat again.
Fire on you.
You have it, do you?
Play this too.
Okay. I want to take you back now to October of 1994, David Roos just finishing that set. Go ahead, guys, play it. October 94. The prophetic words have been great, of course, and even the signs and the weather and the things around us have been amazing. We had a word 7 years ago that we were going majorly higher into signs and wonders, and the guy ended his prophecy by saying, and you'll know this has started when Toronto floods. And we thought, man, I don't know, the Toronto never floods, man, you know. But boy, oh boy, it sure did here last July. Would you believe it was so flooded out in the front, our school of ministry was swimming in the front lawn of the church.
And diving into the water.
Diving into the ditch while cars were floating under the underpass, and our whole 427 highway was like 5 feet of water. It was amazing. Toronto flooded. We just had an ice storm. Unfortunately, we missed it, honey. We were away.
Unfortunately.
But people were without power for 3 days, 4 days, some even a week in this city, because it was so dangerously cold and the ice, and they no sooner got rid of the ice than it got... We all were
in all of your life that it...
Last 20 years has been, Lord, we are not satisfied right here. We give it to you guys in Jesus. Kingdom of God, come. Come now, will of God be done. On earth, in Toronto, just as it is in heaven, in the mighty name of Jesus. Well, turn to someone and say, I'm believing for revival. Hold on. When I get home, it's not going to be the same old, same old. He's coming in power, coming in glory. Come on up, Stace.
Would never walk again.
suddenly, the toes on his left foot began to wiggle. Then the whole foot began to move. Then the other one.
Succeed where others have failed, and they will be radical. And that's the same prophecy God gave her. I didn't know that. See, that's that I didn't know about in July. You know, they said that the wave would hit when Toronto floods, and that was July that happened. And July was the first service of revivals here at church. So that was a confirmation. I don't know if y'all grabbed hold of it. That hit me like a brick last night. I watched that. And I wrote that down. I wanted to show you. I know I took a little bit of time, but I think it was worth it. It was powerful. And let me tell you something. I encourage you to jump into that river and grab a hold of what God has for you. Even in praise and worship, I encourage you just to worship God. Just let God fall on you. Don't worry about anyone else. You just worship God tonight. You hear what I'm telling you. So praise and worship can come forward now, and we'll just get into praising the Lord.
Neighbor that's got a problem with a dog, or you know, it could be anything. But we're loved. We're loved. The Bible says that He loved us when we were still sinners. So we get to extend that love, and we get to give that love back to people that kind of rub us the wrong way and make us feel bad. And just in case, while you're going through it, if you happen to be the neighbor or the spouse or the friend, then just know that God loves you too. 1 John 4:19 said He loved us. He loved us. And that's why we love Him. Let's stand up. We're going to be in the presence of the King. We're going to give Him a little bit of honor here. I was listening to the podcast, and I really need to not sound like a hillbilly. So I am trying to enunciate better.
It does help you listening to yourself.
Oh, it sure does.
All the time, you notice a change. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody stay in a worshipful attitude. Don't get out of focus with what God is doing. Just stay in that worshipful attitude. Let God touch you. He wants to touch you. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I feel God saying He's going to bring people into this church, revivalist here church. He's going to bring them in. He's calling them in. He's calling them in. He's making the sound. He's calling them in. He's calling them in. Like the Pied Piper calls the mice, He's calling the people in. He's calling the harvest in. He said it's time to reap the harvest. It's time to reap the harvest. He's calling them in. He's calling them in. He's going to bring them into this place. He's going to bring them into this place. I hear it being just to be faithful, be faithful, be faithful. He's calling them in. He's calling the harvest in. He wants you to draw close to Him. He wants you to touch you in a powerful way tonight. He wants to touch you. He wants you to be His glory carriers. Are you going to be His glory carriers? Are you going to be His glory carrier? He's asking you a question. He's asking you a question. Are you going to be His glory carriers? Do you want to be His glory carriers? He's asking you a question. It's your choice. Do you want to be a glory carrier?
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. Amen. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Tithing offering time. Everybody take your tithing offering out, put it in your hand and say a blessing. And when somebody comes up, or can you take these back here and sit down? I forgot to get these out. This is the DVDs of last week. Grabbing one. Or give one out to someone. Take your tithing offering in your hand and proclaim. Say, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I speak a blessing over my finances. I
speak a blessing over my finances.
And revival is your church's finances.
And revival is your church's finances.
Let me reap a harvest with this seed.
Let me reap a harvest with this seed.
Let all of my needs be met.
Let my needs be met.
I proclaim it in the name of Jesus.
I proclaim it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
asking God to bless this offering, tithe and offering. Bless the sower, God, that'll reap a harvest. It's a thousandfold, God, in the name of Jesus. Open up the windows of heaven and let the showers of blessing just shower upon them, God, in the name of Jesus. Just to bless them abundantly, God, and let every need that needs to be met, let it be met with this offering, God, in the name of Jesus. And bring people in, God, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, amen. And I break the spirit of poverty off of them in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, amen. You can bring it to your tithes and offerings up at this time. And if someone can grab those DVDs and take them to the back, if you don't mind, and sit them back there on the back counter. Thank you, everyone, for giving. Sorry, I forgot to put those back here, and I didn't think about it until during praise and worship, and that's why I was going through the bag. God reminded me something, I got to do it. If He didn't remind me, I would have took them home. Glory, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Ooh, I feel God. Glory, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. I feel the fire of God. Ooh, glory, hallelujah. Pastor Johnson talked about it this morning and keeps coming to me, kept saying, talking about the salt. And it talks, where does salt be, salt of the earth? And that wasn't talking about its preservative qualities, it's talking about flavor. We are to be have a flavor. Glory, hallelujah, about us. We are to have let our light shine. Glory, hallelujah. So I'm going to talk about that. God changed my sermon. I might end up talking about some happiness here too. God, when we talk about joy. So, or I might hit that next week. But God, He wants to do a work. I don't know if you really grabbed hold of that. That really has hit me right in the stomach when He said to give a prophecy that the signs and wonders was going to increase. And the sign would be when Toronto floods. And Toronto flood, it flooded in July of 2013, he said. July 2013, July 28th, 2013, which was the last Sunday in July. So I don't know what the exact date was when Toronto flooded. That would be something if it flooded on that exact date. But July 28th. Was the first service of revival is here at church. Obviously, I didn't plan that. God did. God's saying something. And the 200th podcast. The 200th podcast, there's more than, the second 2 years of podcasts, I'm sorry, there's under 200 podcasts, but the 2 years of podcast, the podcast that made 2 years. I felt that the 2 years of podcast, it was going to be something special. I kept feeling that. I didn't plan that. Revivals here at church, God just did it. I mean, 1 week, said we're going to have church, revivals here at church, it's going to be the next week. That was that quick. Amen. Didn't plan it. I mean, it just happened. Ask Elder Charles, it just happened. We just went with it. I mean, it was that quick. And I kept feeling the 2 years of podcast, that the one that made 2 years, 2 year anniversary of the podcast was, guess what it was? the very first service of revival was here at church. Mm-hmm. Was the podcast that made, it was 104th, I think it would make 104 weeks, makes 2 years.
Yep.
104th podcast. Mm-hmm. Was the very first service of revival was here at church. The one that made 2 years. I didn't plan that. I didn't know that till afterwards. I said, well, you know, well, praise God, I said that in church. I said, you know what? So God is good.
Amen.
I think He's saying something. He give me, there's been a lot of prophecy spoken over me throughout the years. God's given me prophecies, and a lot of prophecies that God gave me. They was confirmed about it. And God gave me a prophecy about the river. That's why I want to get Sister Ruth here. God gave her a vision about the river. And God gave me several visions about the river. But He gave her a vision that would be one wave and be a big wave right after it. That's what God gave me. It was, well, actually, God, she's seen the middle one and the big one, but God showed me three. When I had this vision, I saw three waves. There was a house, there was a city or something on a kind of a coastline around this way, and there was like a small oceanside city, a little bit small, like you would see, you know, up in Maine. It's a little bit small one. I saw a wave, tidal wave or tsunami, and it come back. Tidal wave, then it come back, then the big one. And God spoke to me. He said, there's three waves of revival. And He told me what the first two was, and they've happened. And the last one's the big one.
Amen.
And she saw the same thing, but she saw the big one and the one before that. So maybe she saw that after I saw mine. Maybe that's why she got, I don't know. But I'm going to try to get her to come and some other people. So pray about that. It's just going to and get people in here. And just, I like to see people touched. That's the biggest thing. I like to see people on the floor getting touched. And when I pray for, I didn't know. I just, God led me to do that. Don't let them up. He wants to touch me. I'm on the operating table. So I pray for them and say, no, God's not done with you. They go back down. It'd be down the whole service a lot of times. It'd be down the whole service. Could crawl out of the church. I mean, our revival's here, church. Could crawl out. People pack them out and pack them into the car, and, you know, pack them out of the car into the house, you know. This happened to revivals here, church. And God said He didn't want to let them up. He wanted to work on them and pray for them more, Lord, and they would go down. And I noticed when I was watching that's what they did. You know, so I know that was from God, which I knew was from God. When if I did it, I know that was from God. You know. God said, tickle me, the testimony. He said, you know, if I laughed, I knew it was from God. Somewhere else did it. I didn't know about that. You know, might think it was a little flash, but you know, if I did it, I knew it had to be from God. He said, but God wants to do work. He told me battle. He told me battle, that's going to have to battle. Then he said accelerate. Battle, then accelerate. But it's going to take a battle. I mean, people are going to come against you. Like Bill Johnson, Pastor Johnson said this morning, have you everybody heard of Smith Wigglesworth?
Yeah.
And all these great men, all these great men of God, these great revivalists. Is it Charles Finley in it?
Yeah.
All these great revivalists, you've heard of these. But nobody can remember their critics.
That's right.
But their critics at that time were just as well known as the people that Smith Wigglesworth had critics. But the critics were just as well known or more well known than the man of God themselves at that time. The critics were big known people. But nobody, over time, nobody remembers the critics. They remember the man of God. So history kind of has a way of remembering the, you know, the as far as church goes, it has a way of remembering to, you talk about the men of God and not the critics. So you're going to have a battle. People's going to come against you, but it's important you just know what God has told you. You just go with it. Let me tell you, when I started Revivals here in ministries, God told me, he gave me the name. He actually told me when I was younger. So I knew it was going to be Revivals here in ministry and Revivals here in church. I didn't want to be by, of course, by my name. And God said he set it up, told me how to do it. So I did it. I had people, you know, I started my own when I first started. And God told me to do the website, so I set it up. He told me to do the podcast, so I did it. I used a little microphone. I had a little webcam. The microphone was really horrible, but I did it. You listen to the first ones, they're still on there. I didn't take them down. God told me to do it, so I did it. First one was maybe a minute or two. Second one, you know, maybe get up 10 minutes. Finally got up to over a CD, you know, had to cut it down because it, you know, it was over that. And I was looking for a mic, a good mic, and God put in my heart to get this one mic. I got it personally, the time, you know, with no donations for a long time. And I was wanting this one mic. It's a $150 mic, but it's on sale. It was on sale for $89. And it's a USB mic for the computer, and I wanted that one, and God told me to get that one. But I didn't have the money. God told me to go count my change. So I went to the store and put it in the thing, and you can get a gift certificate, and it won't cost you for counting it. So I put it in there, the machine counted it, and I had enough money to get that mic. I had enough money and change to get that mic. That was a miracle itself, because there wasn't that much change there. So God, I believe God multiplied it. It wasn't that much changing. So I got the mic. So I started recording better. Been just recorded. Sometimes I feel like giving up. I'm going to be honest with you. I felt like giving up. No donations in. People discouraging you. Have other ministers coming against you. And all this stuff. You feel like, it's like I can't go on. God said, just keep going. Just keep going. Just keep going. So I just keep going.
That's right.
Keep going. Sometimes people would donate, and then they got to when they wrong reason why they donate because they thought they could control everything. Uh-huh. And they pick and all this stuff. And I told them, I said, well, I'm ahead of it. God's told me to do this. So we're going to do it this way.
That's right.
So they get mad, you know. And that's the way it was. You know, I just donated myself. And when I need something, I just finally got the checking account. Well, I'll just paint me completely out of mine. Then I end up, we got the checking account. Then it was me putting it in the church, the ministry checking account. Then pay it wasn't still me. Then people would help. Then other people finally, you know, then they come and go, you know, help and stuff. And it seemed like God wanted me to rely on him. He wanted me to be under him. Because like every time someone come in to help, and I get relying on them, then they would leave. And God wanted me to make sure, he wanted me to be under him. To listen to him. Amen. And someone said, you got to be undercover. And I said, well, you know, which I am ordained under someone. I said, but who's this? Who in your covering, who is he under? God. That's why I want to be under him too. That's the
Amen.
Same person I'm under.
Amen. That's right.
Amen.
But you do need a covering. I'm not saying that. But for me, that's what God told me. That's what he wanted. Because he had a set agenda he wanted done. So every step, I just followed the Holy Spirit. And I just did what God told me to do. I wasn't even planning on this. Every step, God told me. When I got the lawyer, God got him. He was sitting right behind me. Literally sitting right. I went to the 99. God told me to go that night. That's a little outreach they have, and they had in Louisville. It's kind of like a haunted house, but it's Christian to get people saved. And afterwards, they have counselors, and I was on one side, you know, the men's on one side, women on the other. I turned around talking to a guy sitting behind me, his brother Brian Weber. And God sent me to this one church I was going to at the time. I was going to one church, and he said, you've gone as far as you can there. I want you to go somewhere where I can use you. So I went to another one. God told me to go there. I was turning around talking to him. I asked him where he was going. He said, it's that church. I said, really? He said, that's where I go. I said, really? And he says, I'm a lawyer. I said, really? I said, I just prayed for some guy to send me a godly lawyer. So guess what he did the paperwork? Him. It literally approved it in 1 month. The IRS approved the tax exempt status in 1 month. No calls, no questions, nothing. I got a paper saying it was approved. Now that's God there.
Amen.
I mean, most the shortest at that time was 6 months. Most time they had to wait years. Because you heard all that stuff would come out. And I'm not complaining about the IRS at all. I'm just telling you, I heard about all that. And, well, we didn't have 1 month. Ask Elder Charles. He could tell you. Didn't he?
Amen.
So God, every step of the way, he guided me. He told me exactly, every step, what to do, when to do it, and when to stop. God told me to do a radio service. Okay, I'll do it. So I called over the air. And that was going to be way, 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 way up there. And I was paying for it. It was like $250 a half hour for one time a week. That's over the radio. I said, I can't pay that. That's just too much. And just got opened over internet radio. That turned out that was probably bigger than over the air. And it was like 2,000. We had it twice a week. I had it. And it was like 2,000 people listened to it twice a week, each one. And 3 hours of was doing it twice a week. At one time, I got up to doing it twice a week, 3 hours, well, 6 hours a week. And God give me words and just prophesy, and I would play some music and then preach and prophesy and play some music and just do that. And over the internet, and God opened the door for television. I did that, and they got too much doing the internet radio. God said, okay, cut that off. And now focus toward video. So every step of the way, God guided me. Every step. But sometimes you feel like you just want to give up. You just can't do it. And you feel, I'm going to be honest with you, you get discouraged, you know. And all these people coming against you, you feel like you can't do it. But God says, hang on. Hang on. Hang on. That's why, God, you called me to be a pastor. I'm going to be a pastor. How about these other pastors saying, you're called to be a pastor. I went to help out this outreach of this church I was going to at the time. They had it in a park. And set up the big thing to have a concert, Christian concert, and they had some bounties for the kids. And this one lady came up, thought I was the pastor. And I wasn't the pastor. So I was like, I know, you know, I said, God, you called me to be a pastor. I said, be faithful, be faithful. Finally, I got the point. I said, all right, God, it's yours. Do you want it? You take it. It's not mine. I said, just take it. And real quick after that, I mean, it just happened. In revivals here at church, it happened. I mean, literally, I had no choice in the matter, really. I mean, it was like, they already told everybody, we're going to have revival. You know, he's going to have church services on the Sunday nights at that location. They already told everybody. I said, well, I hope that's okay. We told everybody already. So I literally, it happened, and I didn't have no choice in the matter. Ask Elder Charles about mom about that. I said, well, I guess it's okay. So we started having them. So I gave it to God. And I'm Mr. Ordained, of course, senior pastor in CGIA and under Yonggi Cho. He's a revivalist. And but they don't interfere with things. And that's good. I mean, that's really good.
Amen.
And we made sure of that. Me and Elder Charles both made sure of that. Before we And I just felt like going to that. But it was a time where I didn't think it was going to happen. Right before a Bible Here church started, I had just going to a little small church for a while. I said, I just can't drive down to Louisville. I just can't do it. I'm just doing too much. And it was really stressful. It was a stressful time for me. I kept praying. It was literally just hanging on to God. And David had those moments. You just hang on to God. And let me tell you something. It's a battle sometimes. Yes. But you got to be battle. You got to hang on. You got to know what God tells you. And you don't let anyone talk you out of it.
That's right.
So this is the way God told me to do it. So this is the way it's going to be done. Either you can go along with it or you can stay behind.
That's right.
Amen.
I've had to do that several times. I put my foot down. I'm easy on God, but don't think that I can't put my foot down. I'm not saying this against anyone here, but I'm just saying. I've had to do that. Ask Elder Charles. I call him, get counsel, and said, what do you think? You go with what God told you. So it would always work out. But when I did exactly the way God told me to the T, it worked out. By going to 99 that night, it worked out. Walking to a certain gas station at a certain time, seeing someone I needed to, it worked out perfect. I got down to where we needed $200 or something like that to pay for all the fees and stuff to get it incorporated, all that taken care of, and tax exempt. $200. But it was earlier that month, I felt at this deadline. I said, we're going to get all the money. It was quite a sum. By the very end of this month, I'm dropping that. I'm staying the way we are. We're going to keep on going. I said, I'm not going to worry about it. Ask Elder Charles. I said, it's going to be at the very end of this month. We're going to get the money, or we're going to use the money for something else. We're not going to worry about getting tax exempt and not incorporating all that. We're just going to keep going. It's too much worry. I'm not going to worry about it. This is the deadline. Guess what? Was it the very last day? I think it was the very last day of that month. Guess what? I got a phone call. I got a check for you for $200. So guess what? I went and picked it up. Very last day.
Amen.
So that was God saying.
Confirmation. Go.
He wanted it done. So you got to know what God has told you. And you just got to. Don't worry about anyone. Thanks. Don't worry about it. You just keep on going. You just keep on going. You know what he told you, and you just do it. I know at least somebody here while listening to us getting something out of it. I might be later. Getting all quiet in here. You have people come against you. You have them share their opinions. They'll try to pull you. See, that's what the devil do. They'll try to get someone to pull you. But you know, this is what God called me to do. Sometimes it gets hard, but you got to know what he's. You got to get that vision. So that vision of people perish. You got to have that vision in front of you. Since in Isaiah 60, this is where my sermon I'm supposed to be talking about is right here. Isaiah 60. It says, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you." So it didn't say it was coming. It has come. It's talking to us right now. This is right here. But Jesus, his light's already come. Jesus.
Amen.
So we are the light of this world because of Jesus. We're like a reflection. He's shining on us, shining through us.
Amen.
And the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Glory of the Lord. That's something we've been talking about. Glory of the Lord. Presence of God. And we need the presence of God. We need the presence of God. We need it in this, even more in this church. We need to be glory carriers. We need to have what God has for us. We need to walk in His glory. If you watch those things from the Toronto blessing and talk about the presence, so hungry for His presence. They would go to 3 o'clock in the morning. That's common. Because God shows up. Nobody wants to leave. I've been in those services. I've been there in those services. I didn't go to Toronto blessing, but I've been in those services. I mean, you didn't want to leave. My grandmother went with me. She didn't want to leave. She likes to go to bed early. She didn't want to leave. She went with me. She didn't want to leave. I had told her to leave one day because I was tired. I would work, then go home and get dressed. We would go. Work all day, go home and soak all night. And in the presence. But one time I was so tired, the guy was speaking. He was just a teacher. And just, I said, Grandma, she got so mad. She got mad all the way home with me because she was really listening to that teacher. I said, I can't help it. I'm driving. I can't make it home. She got mad. She enjoyed it. She liked going up there. When God comes, if His glory comes, you just want to stay there. I've seen, you know, people like, they don't want to go. You got to brush them out, you know. I'm talking about young people, making them leave. You have to make them leave. Young people. God's there.
Amen.
I've seen this. I've experienced that. I've been in that. Times that I get home really late. It's in the presence of God at church. I've been in that. And I'm hungry and I want more. I want to hear. Getting out at 9 o'clock is too early.
Amen.
We need God to come down even more. You hear what I'm telling you. When we get our own building, let me tell you something. It's going to be, whoo. I'm praying for it. We're going to have a good time here, but I'm praying for getting our own building debt-free and everything, you know.
Amen.
What I'm saying.
Amen.
Get that house filled up with hungry people. That's what we need, some hungry people. You hear what I'm telling you. Some hungry people. Trial blessing, they was filled with some hungry people coming out. He told you, the pastor, I was just hungry people was coming. I was hungry. You hear what I'm telling you?
Amen.
The Acts, book of Acts, it was some hungry people. They weren't looking at the clock, said, what time is it? Oh, I'm getting bored. Pastor Chan's going a little bit too long, you know.
Come on.
Oh, we get too long here. What's saying that? They was waiting and tarrying until the Holy Spirit came. You hear what I'm telling you? They was tarrying. They was waiting. They was hungry. Jesus told them to wait, so they waited. You hear what I'm telling you? They were looking at no clocks. They waited. Sometimes God, He does that to you. He'll just see if you're obedient. Just see if you're really hungry. He did that to Sister Pastor Carol Arnott. Told her to go. He just sent out this test to you to see if you obeyed. We got to do that sometime. Just to see. Are you really hungry? Are you really hungry? Are you really to just tarry and wait just for the presence? Sometimes God don't show up really strong until after 12. He'll tell you that. Tell you that Toronto blessing and tell you that Brownsville revival. Both of them say the same thing. After 12 o'clock, God really showed up. I mean, God showed up, but He really showed up after 12.
Amen.
He tell you, you heard one there? They're just looking at people when they fall down. Falling down in the presence of God in the elevator, just going up, going back down. Because they had that conference at the Constellation Hotel. They tore it down now, he said, but that's where it was. And that's where they got a hit. That guy, the church was just too small. They started out in a school, then he went to a little church building, and they had one of the conference room, and they finally went to their current one. And they've got all kinds of them, 10 maybe, I don't know. They got one in London. But you got to be, Terry, you got to be hungry. Are you hungry? You want God to have His glory to rise upon you. Are you wanting that? Do you want Him?
Yes. Ooh,
I think
amen.
I'm
hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, I thought I was preaching the wrong place. I didn't know. It says, for behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and darkness, deep darkness, the people, but the Lord will arise over you, and His glory will be seen upon you. I want to tell you, I've told you this a million times, but I'm going to tell you, this right here, Isaiah 60, was that vision that God gave me. When I was a child, I was young. God, I looked down and I seen the map of America. It was black. It was dark. Then I looked down towards. I was down in like our valley, looking up like this northeast. and still dark. Then all of a sudden I was on top of a mountain. Then I seen like lights, like car lights, going up to the mountain, going across from east to west. And God speaking to Jesus, after I saw that, he said, this is the way I'm going to come. To make a long story short, he made sure I told people it's coming from the east to west, from right to left. And when I told people that vision, don't forget to tell them it's from the east to west. And I was praying about it. Then God told me, America is dark right now. I was kept years, this was a couple years ago, he finally told me. I was young when he gave me the vision. And he told me what it meant. He said, we're dark in America now. The car lights are the people. And he's going to send a revival to America all the way from the east coast to the west coast. And it's going to be on the people, and this light's going to shine. But what's this telling you right here? It's gross darkness has covered the earth, and darkness, deep darkness, the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. So that's why I want to read this, talk about this. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. Where's the sunrise? From the east to the west. There you go. Lift up your eyes all around and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your son shall come from afar, and your daughter shall be nursed at your side. Then you shall see and become radiant. Woo! And your heart shall swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you, and the wealth of the Gentiles shall come to you. The sea, the wave, the tidal wave. Yeah. Abundance, wealth is going to come. Going to swell with joy. Woo! Glory, hallelujah. I claim this in the name of Jesus. The multitude of camels shall cover your land, and the dromedaries of Midian and Ephah, all those from Sheba shall come, and they shall bring gold and incense, and they shall proclaim the praises of the Lord. And the flocks of Kedar shall be gathered to you, the rams of Nebothah shall minister to you, and they shall ascend with acceptance on my altar, and I will glorify the house of my glory. Woo, glory, hallelujah, praise ye. Who are these who fly like a cloud and like doves to the roost? Surely the coastlands shall wait for me. There you go, the coast. And the ships of Tarshish will come first to bring your sons from afar, their silver and their gold with them in the name of the Lord your God and to the Holy One of Israel, because he has glorified you. The sons of foreigners shall bring up your walls, and their kings shall minister to you. For in my wrath I struck you, but in my favor I have had mercy on you. Therefore, your gates shall be open continually, 24-hour service. There shall not be shut day or night, that men may bring to you the wealth of the Gentiles and their kings in your possession. In the procession, it goes along here. Glory of God on of his people. It was talking about camels and things. That's how they measured wealth back then. It's how many camels and how much livestock you had. If you had a lot of them, he was rich. That's Abraham. He had a lot of them, so he was rich. So you're going to be rich. God's going to touch you. He's going to bring people in. He's going to draw a man. He's going to bring a man. His glory's going to fall. Then we get born again.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
Glory, hallelujah. That's for revival. It's your church. That's for now. Because God's giving me this vision, and it's right here. God, are you with me? You still with me?
Amen.
Do you want a revival? You want a move of God? Come on now. Come on now.
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. Can I get a witness up in this house tonight?
Amen. Hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah.
Praise
thank you,
Lord.
Jesus. Your gates shall be open continually. Woo! Glory, hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm for that, aren't you? Glory, amen. Hallelujah. I'm ready for a move of God, even stronger than what we had.
Yes.
He's going to bring people in. God's going to bring them in. He talks about the city to set up on a hill. People's going to come.
That's right.
Come and hear the wisdom. Like Solomon's a picture of the church. Amen. They come to Solomon and heard, you know, hear all this wisdom and everything. That's going to be for us, the revivals here at church. Glory, hallelujah.
Amen.
Y'all need to get excited about that.
Amen. Amen.
Got a lot of people excited about a football game. I'm telling you what, I'm going to do cartwheels for Jesus.
That's right.
Amen.
He set me free. You hear what I'm telling you? Got a miracle in here. How's your everything going there still? Glory, hallelujah. She has a miracle. Turned out that it wasn't broken. It was the first scan said it was. Second one
said it wasn't.
After we got you got prayed for, you went back and did another scan.
Yeah.
Then it was healed.
I still have a lot of pain and dislocation. And when the muscles heal, I'll be done with.
But God healed her spine.
Yes, He did.
The only one that was from a long time ago.
That's right.
First scan. I don't know if you heard that. Mm-hmm. Tell it again. Say it real loud so they can hear it. I mean, really screaming.
The first x-ray that was done revealed a C3, C4 vertebrae fracture. Last Sunday night, I was prayed for and I had my carpet time. I went home and still had carpet time. But,
that happens a lot in my mom's here.
I had another x-ray done on Monday and they sent it out to a specialist, have it evaluated, came back and showed a C something vertebrae that had been broken a long time ago, but the C3, 4, 5, they're still dislocated, but they're not broken.
The first one said it was.
Yeah.
First one said it was. Do you get that? That's a doctor verifying miracle.
Yes.
Y'all need to get excited about that. Well, I don't know about you, but that makes me excited. That's
Amen.
Time to praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
Come on now, let's praise the Lord in there. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Come on now. We need
Amen.
To praise the Lord for that. That's a miracle.
Lord.
We know a doctor can do that. We need to get excited about that.
Amen.
Get excited about those things.
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. We hear praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory.
Glory,
thank
hallelujah.
You, Jesus.
That's something to be excited about in this place tonight.
That's right.
How's your gums there, brother?
Still bleeding.
Is it?
Yeah.
Well, we had three miracles that night. Glory, hallelujah. God is good.
All the time.
That's right, God is good. Woo, glory, hallelujah. He wants to raise up some radical people.
Yes, He does.
Glory, hallelujah. Talk about the everlasting life. That's a good chapter. Y'all need to read that. I got a whole bunch of good verses here, a whole page full of verses right here of joy. But I'm going to do that for you next week. Get some joy.
Amen.
God told me for a while, He wants to, that's right, He wants to focus on a lot of people, some inner healing. He wants to do some inner healing that's hindering them from getting real close to Him, and it's hindering that they're being held back even from doing what God called them to do, and from getting close, and maybe even getting excited and worshiping Him, and getting free in worship, you know. And He wants to do some inner healing. He told me that that's what He wants to focus on for a while, some inner healing. That some people need some inner healing. It's a lot of... I'm going to say it. If you get people get mad, they get mad. Ain't my problem. Talk to God about it.
Right.
He said there's some people that's been hurt in some churches that He wants to do some inner healing on. There's been some pastors that's been kind of a little overly controlling and stuff. Not just one. There's some numerous of them. One, been some over controlling pastors and not encouraging the people and not pushing them, and they go in their ministry and they've been held them back, and a lot of other things that they've been hurt, they've been scarred, and God wants to heal them. That's what He said. And He wants to do some inner healing and some setting free and some really just some good things there. And that's what He told me. And He's going to accelerate. And God's going to bring people in. The prophecy God, the guy He spoke to, Pat, the brother of Bethel, and they gave to me, people's going to come in. God's bringing them into him. and it, for me being like apostolic role and stuff like that. And as God's gonna, he's doing the work, you know, he's getting some odds, a lot of good words. And you just to hang in there, and you just do what God has for you, and you just soak in his presence, just a lather in it. How many knows you're not worried about the time if you're on the carpet? You don't know what time it is. It's like, they get up, oh, it's just, I thought it was earlier than that, you know. They don't know what, they just get lost, you know, in the presence. I've heard people just get lost in, some people got touched here. They'd be lost in all night. They'd be lost under the power. They'd think about it, and God just hit them again. The revival is here at church. I've heard testimonies about that. I can tell you their names. And these powerful things. So you just need to let go and just let God just love on you. And when God comes down, don't just be thinking about going praying for somebody. Maybe God wants to just touch you and you to do carpet time. You know, just to love on you. Just whammy you, you know. It's like, hey, I know they're over there. I know. I want to talk to you right now, you know. You know what I'm saying? It's happened a lot, you know. So I just want to pray, you know. The other churches I would go out there with all the pastors and say, you know, you got free reign. You just, God tell you something. I don't care what time it is. You grab the mic and say it. You go pray for them. You got the freedom. So if God talked to me, tell me things. So I just sit there because I knew it's for me. You know, I'm going to get touched myself. You know what I mean?
Yes, amen.
So sometimes he wants to love on you, you know. And yeah, all the time. He wants to love on them. And Benny, you didn't hear that testimony, but she was in, you know, really bad shape. And God, she was a pastor. The church was 2,000 people at the time. And, well, her and her husband was pastors, Bill and Benny Johnson. God hit her, and she was just down for a long time. They had to carry her out to the car and everything. And she was shaking. And God said he had to shake some stuff out of her. And he just hit her, and she went back and was just completely different person, started women's groups and all this stuff. And then she imparted, but God worked on her. He tell you, all these men of God, they all went down under power, and God worked on them. And he just, you know, breathed into them. You know, the apostles, God breathed into them. You know, they was part of it before they was even believed.
That's right.
Amen.
They was called in one of the 12, and they didn't even believe. That's something for you. God has a call on each and every one of you. And if you, are you alive?
Amen.
Are you alive? Everybody say amen to life.
Amen.
So God has a call on you. I heard you say amen. You said amen, didn't you? She say amen? Mm-hmm. You say amen? You say amen? If you are alive, you have a call on your life.
That's right.
So everybody's alive here. Ain't no dead people. We raise you up.
Amen.
See, a lot of dead people, a lot of churches.
That's right.
What God's saying, can these bones live? A lot of dead people, a lot of churches. You go to church service. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. I'm happy. You know, when they sing their song, they just make a frown on their face when they're singing the song. Just sit there and their arms crossed. They're just so sad. It's like they want to beat somebody up. They just got this look on their face. Like you said, well, I thought that was L.A. go to church, you know. I'm laughing, y'all. In church, laughing? That's where it should be, laughing in church.
Amen.
That's where the light should be. If too long, there's ain't been no laughing in church. For too long, it's a bunch of frowning, a bunch of dead, dry bones. He said you got a bunch of whitewashed walls, but you got a bunch of dead man bones inside. Jesus preached that to the church, to the religious people of that day. And that's what he's saying now. That sermon rings true today. It's come back full circle. Got a bunch of dead people in church.
Amen.
Bunch of judgmental dead people that don't have no power in them. There's no God inside of them. There's nothing there. But they go to church all the time, going through the ritual just to be seen.
That's right.
They got a big frown on their face so everybody see how reverent they are.
Yeah.
Come on.
Doing it for show. They wear the big old clothes like Jesus preached about. Want to be seen, and so they wear the nice clothes. Their phylactery, Jesus preached that sermon.
Come on.
They want to be seen. But you got that in church. They want to be seen. What'd you see the clothes that they wore up their trial bus? What'd you see them wearing? Did you see them wearing fancy?
Jeans, bare feet. Yes.
I like to wear suits. But I'm not doing that to everybody as they look at me. But the thieves are not high priced suits, by the way. I can't afford it. But that's when God shows up, you're not, you know. Worry about getting your nice hairdo and going, you know, get your tan and get, you know, going to beauty, you know, and all this stuff, and your man going to all these fancy salon, you know, doing all this stuff, you know, and they want, you know, to be seen. They need to be seen by God instead.
That's right.
They need to be seen by God instead. One, you should be seen by God. Say, hey, look at me. Like a man crying out to Jesus. Hey, I'm over here to be seen by God. The God to come down and touch you. That's what we need. We need some life back in us again.
That's right.
We need to get into praise and worship. We need to dance and praise the Lord like the Bible says to do. And praise the Lord and get into the worship. You see me into it. You know, for a while I was bound up to, you know what, until I got revivals here at church. Oddly enough, God touched me too.
Amen.
So we need to praise the Lord again. We need to worship Him. Just get in there, just praise Him and not worry about it. You see, I don't know if you saw that. You heard this old lady, an older lady, God hit her and she started shaking and fell down. So it don't matter your age.
That's right.
Most of the time, you see the older people, they get more into it than the younger people. When they, you know, get hit the hardest. I don't want you to get late, but you know, God's not, He don't got no timetable. He didn't say, you know, He's a God of the night too, you know, He didn't say that. I won't catch time, you know. So, we need to just go after God. We need to just be hungry for Him. And Just worship Him. They should say, you know that revival is here at church. Boy, they just know how to worship. They just know how to get into God's presence. God's just there. When that has that, soon as Pastor Chance and whoever it is at the time stands behind the pulpit and opens up the service, whoever it is that they say, whoever it is to stand behind it, God just falls. And the worship just amazing. You know what? They said, I even got healed when he stood behind there and just said the first word, opened up the service, God came down and healed me right then. I got set free. I said, you know, I want to give people, give them testimonies a little later. You know what? As soon as he opened up the service, God hit me and I fell down. I was out for hours, the whole day, the whole night. That's what he wants to do. People, there's thousands coming in, there's hungry from all around the world. He said, you go bring in the nation. What he told me. And that was confirmed from Bethel Church. Bringing in the nations. You know, if someone comes from Iraq and Iran and get a touch from God, they're going to be pretty upset because the service is only 2 hours.
Right.
you know, 4 hours. It was over four and a half hours up there at the trial blessing during that anniversary. And that's when they cut off the recording. They were going all night praying for people. They just started praying for people 4.5 hours. And everybody got prayed for. There's like 3,000-4,000 there. Place was packed out. So we need to just go after God and just want to get whammy and just expect great things. Expect to be glory carrier and His light to shine upon you. Amen.
Amen.
Invite some more people out. Invite 20, bring 20 with you. Next week, I got these little things back here that you can pick up and hand out to people. Be a good witness. It's a book of John back there. And be a good witness handing those out. And I got the little cards. Like this. You got the front and back. You can hand out for the information. And the business cards of the stuff back there. And so everybody grab a bunch of that. And some DVDs of the services. I know if you don't want the DVD, you can grab one and hand it to someone who's a good witness. Say, hey, look what God's doing. There's some testimonies that's on there. It's when God showed up last week. It should show up every week. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
He does.
Amen. And just witness to people. I tell them, and I've got a thing up at one of those at the bank, and we'll bring some other places and put them up. Just put those little index cards up, you know. And I'm just going to be... I'm going to be very pesterous to people to get them to come to some revivalists to get them to come out. So I'm going to email them all the time saying, come, I need you, we need you, come out, we're hungry. You know, I'm a pastor, senior pastor, and I'm telling you I'm hungry, so come out. And so I'm going to be emailing them a lot and get them to come. So it's going to cost some money, I'm sure, but we just need to do it. You hear me?
Amen.
You just need to do it. Just step out in faith. So I'm excited about that. I'm going to be the one on the floor over there. I'm a big guy. I can get loud when God touches me. Trust me. I have no attention to it. It just happens. You know what I'm saying? I have no idea what happens. I just cut loose. Just God is me. And I don't get worried about what other people's thinking. You know, some people, they hold it back because they fight. But sometimes the more you fight it, the more he's going to hit you.
That's
right. So that's happened to me. The more I fought it, the more he's hit me. So say a closing prayer. Thank everyone come out. Thank everyone for the giving. I give too. Everything goes towards the ministry. God, I want to thank you for this time of you. It was a powerful time of you, God. Thank you for showing up. Keep bringing more people in, God. Bring the hungry in and just whammy on them, God, in the name of Jesus. I ask you, God, to fill this place full of you and people. Bless them in their going. Help them to drive safely and to come back next week, God. In the name of Jesus. I want to thank this. I thank you for this time, God. Thank you for the food that we had before the service to celebrate. Our new meeting room that you gave us, God, you literally gave us this room, God. I want to thank you for it. And then I ask you, and we all ask you, that we have our own building, somebody just donate to us. I got one in mind that's down the road here. Used to be a little exercise place. I don't think that'd be a good place, God, that someone just donate to revivals here at church.
Yes.
And have enough, they donate the money to fix it up. Yes. I claim it, God, and I ask you to do it. Bring people in here. Bring the finances, God. And bless everyone and they're going. And get them to come back and bring more people with them, God. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thank you for coming out.